Hi guys. Happy, what day is it? Tuesday afternoon? Happy Tuesday afternoon, everybody. I just like kicked butt with all of my, I don't want to be spiking the mic. I just kicked butt with all of my housework tasks. So I figured I got like 45 minutes to an hour to kill. I kind of want to read some more Stay Tuned for Danger. Well, let's do a quick reading stream. So we probably will only get like 2 or 3 chapters done, but I'm okay with that. Any progress is progress, right? So thanks for being here. If you're watching this after the fact, thanks for rewatching. And I hope your weeks are going good. Without too much further ado, I don't know if there's anybody here, but if so, welcome. And I'm going to jump back in. Chapter 6. Listen, Bess. Maddie relaxed her stare a bit, trying not to look so severe. I really don't want to upset you, but honestly, Rick can really love them and leave them. Maybe it's because deep down inside he's very unsure of himself, or maybe he's become too successful too fast, and sometimes I wonder if he can really handle it. Rick? Unsure of himself? Bess shook her head in disbelief. I'm sorry, Maddie. I don't think you know the real Rick. Maybe not, but I've known him a long time. We did summer stock together years ago. He was different then. Warm and sincere. In the past few years, he's really changed. He can be so cold now, even cruel. Well, maybe he just hasn't met the right girl yet, Bess suggested. Wait a minute, Nancy interrupted. Maddie, why are you so concerned about a man you've just told us is cold, cruel, and steps on people? Oh, I don't know, Maddie answered softly. I guess I still think of him as a friend, even if it didn't work out between us. Looking over at Nancy imploringly, she added, Rick would never admit it, but I'm sure that way down deep he's scared. I'd just feel so much better if you were on the set tomorrow. Bess rolled her eyes and got up from the table. Nancy watched her go. She hoped Bess knew what she was doing where Rick was concerned. I'd like to be there myself, Nancy replied, turning back to Maddie. But now that the set's closed to visitors... Wait a minute, Maddie cried. Her eyes shimmered with excitement. I just got a brilliant idea. We're shooting a hospital scene tomorrow, and I'll bet I could get you and Bess jobs as extras. What do you think? Will you do it? Across the kitchen, Bess couldn't help jumping up and down with excitement. That would be fantastic. Nancy thought for a moment. Are you sure you could do it? Almost sure. Here, let me call the casting director. Eloise, do you have a phone book handy? Nancy's aunt brought the book over as Bess unloaded the dishwasher. Just imagine Nancy appearing on my favorite soap. We're in luck, Maddie announced, hanging up the phone a few minutes later. She says you two can be nurses. Just report to the studio at 7 sharp and go straight to the costume room as soon as you get there. But what if people recognize you? Maddie wondered out loud. Oh, they won't recognize you. Maddie laughed and stood up to leave. No one ever looks at the extras. Besides, when you're on camera, you'll probably have wigs and uniforms on, and you probably won't even recognize yourselves. You know, Nancy, Bess said after Maddie had gone. No matter what anyone says, I've read that a lot of big stars started out as extras. You never know, this could be my lucky break. Bess and Nancy had reported to the studio at 7 the next morning. After the dry blocking in which they learned what they were to do, they reported to makeup and wardrobe. Now, standing on pedestals as two wardrobe people finished their final fittings for the dress rehearsal, Bess and Nancy couldn't help giggling. You're really a knockout as a brunette, Nancy, Bess said. Nancy looked over at her friend who was wearing an identical uniform. She had a white nurse's cap over her bright red wig, and Nancy had never seen her look more excited. Your dress rehearsal will be third, ladies, a production assistant told them. After the big love scene, which is the second, report to Lillian. You know where to stand and what to do from the first rehearsal, so break a leg. Oh, if you want to catch Rick and Maddie in rehearsal, you can. Rory and Serena are going to have a big scene. It's supposed to be pretty hot stuff. Bess immediately dashed down the corridor to the set, determined not to miss a word of Maddie and Rick's scene. It was all Nancy could do to keep up with her. Watching the cast and crew gather around the set of Serena Livingstone's living room, Nancy could feel their edginess. The near disaster of the day before had obviously gotten to everyone. Even though the set was closed to outsiders, Nancy could tell that nobody was truly safe. The only person who seemed at ease was Rick. Flashing a smile at Bess, he walked onto the set. He looked as if he were on top of the world. He took his place in the middle of the set, and slowly Rick Arlen seemed to fade away. When the director finally called action, he had become Rory Danner. In the scene, Rory was supposed to tell Serena that he'd be hers forever if she would have him. Even though it was an intense scene, Nancy noticed that Rick was reading nearly all his lines from the teleprompter. But then, with all the excitement the day before, she reasoned, he probably hadn't had time to memorize them. Maddie was having trouble with her lines, too. She had excused herself early the night before to go home and work, but obviously she didn't remember much. Although she was really throwing herself into the scene, Nancy noticed that she, too, kept glancing over at her teleprompter to check her lines. "Should I leave, Serena? Is that what you want?" Rick asked, pacing in front of Maddie nervously. "No, Rory, don't go. I love you," Serena said. Her voice was quivering and her emerald eyes were full of tears. "I've always loved you, even when you didn't want me." "Cut," came the director's voice. "Maddie, I need you to cool it a little. If you start the scene at such a high emotional pitch, we won't have anywhere to go." "Right, Luther." Maddie nodded up to the director's booth. "Okay, everyone, take it from should I leave," Lillian ordered. "Should I leave, Serena? Is that what you want?" Rick asked. "No, Rory, don't go. I love you. I've always loved you, even when you didn't want me." They were into it by then. Maddie and Rick were utterly convincing, making everyone who was watching really believe they were desperately in love. Bess had tears in her eyes as she watched them move slowly toward each other. Finally, Serena collapsed in Rory's arms. "Here comes her big speech," Lillian muttered under her breath to nobody in particular. "Watch her screw it up." Oh, Rory, I want to do so many things with you, Mattie whispered hoarsely. I want to take walks in the rain with you. I want to sit with you under the stars on deserted beaches. I want to dance with you and sing with you to... Mattie suddenly fell silent. She stood as if frozen, her eyes fixed on the teleprompter, her beautiful face a terrible white. Then, as everyone looked on in horror, she let out a blood-curdling scream and slumped slowly to the floor. End of chapter 6. Yeah, hey Paige, hey Manny, or Timo. Yeah, when you said, I don't want to see you, Serena, it was so funny. I just kept thinking. But I think there's, I think in the game, too, she goes, no, Rory, don't go. I think she says that. I love you, or something like that. But, so that's end of chapter 6. Hey, E. If I pull my mic away from my mouth a little bit, can you guys still hear me okay? I don't want to, like, completely lose the level. But I think I might be, like, blowing in everybody's ears, or if I move it down like that. Stay tuned for danger. So great. So if I move it, like, out of my mouth, out of the way of my mouth and down a little bit. Your Wii really wanted... Wait, were you streaming? I didn't even know. I'm a little quiet now. Okay. How's that? Is that a little bit better? I just don't want to be, like, blowing in your ears. Oh, you haven't played Stay Tuned for Danger? It's a good one. It's a good one. It's a little dated now. It would be nice if we could get, like, a remaster one day, but I also want to get mid, so... We'll see. Okay. On to chapter 7. Mattie! Mattie! What happened? Is she all right? Don't touch her! Everyone gathered around Mattie, who was lying on the floor. After what seemed forever, her eyes began to flutter open. She looked dazed. Mattie struggled to her feet with Rick's help. The look in her eyes only grew wilder. Look! She cried, pointing to the teleprompter. Her monologue had been changed. It read... I want to dance with you, to sing with you, to murder you. Yes, your time is up, Rick Arlen. I'm going to kill you. I'm going to watch you die a horrible death, and I'm going to laugh. What in the name of... What is this? Pappas yelled. Give me the teleprompter operator. I want to talk to her right now. I'm here, Mr. Pappas. A short red-haired girl spoke up. Would you care to explain this? He asked, arching his eyebrows. Well, sir, I really can't explain it, the girl stammered. I got here early to type in the scene, and I was at the keyboard all morning. The only time I left was to take a phone call, and I know I wasn't gone for more than a minute because when I picked up the phone, there was no one there. I didn't think that... Exactly, you didn't think. Papa shot the operator a harsh look. You're fired, and whoever's job it was to keep strangers off this set, you're fired too. Then to the frightened cast and crew, he said, I'll fire every last one of you if I have to. This nonsense has got to stop. Nancy watched the producer from the sidelines. He seemed genuinely concerned, but what if it was all an act? What if beneath all his theatrics there was something completely different going on? Something much more calculated and sinister. She noticed Lillian Weiss, too. Lillian was off in a corner trying to be inconspicuous, but nothing could hide the pleased look on her face. She was loving every minute of this. Okay, everybody, Luther's voice boomed from the director's booth. Lunch break, and when we come back, let's try to get this show back on schedule, will we? Calm down, Mattie. You're not going to let some practical joker ruin your entire day, are you? Rick opened the front door of the studio for them, and Mattie, Bess, and Nancy filed past him onto the sidewalk. Come on, he added with a grin. Let me treat you all to lunch while I'm still alive. Stop it! Stop pretending that everything is fine! Mattie turned on him, her green eyes flashing. You've got to be terrified. Why don't you just come out and admit it? Me? Terrified? Don't be ridiculous. They can't kill me. The world needs me. Besides, it'd spoil the ratings if I died. I could just punch you, Mattie growled, and I'll pay for my own lunch, thank you. Whatever you say, Rick shrugged. I'll just have to treat Bess and Nancy, of course. Right, lately? Right, ladies? Bess and Nancy said nothing, embarrassed by the way Rick was taunting Maddie. Nancy started to walk off by herself. "Hey, look who's here," said Rick, his attention caught by a man at the studio door. "It's the president of the Losers League himself. Hi, Dwayne." Dwayne Casper, Maddie's agent, rushed up to them, pointedly ignoring Rick's remark. Nancy stopped and observed the scene a short distance from the others. "Maddie," he cried, throwing his arms around her. "I was bringing some of your new headshots to the front office and I heard what happened. It's absolutely outrageous. Are you all right, darling?" "Oh, I suppose so," Maddie replied softly, shaking free of his embrace. "It was awfully upsetting, but..." "But nothing," Dwayne said, interrupting. "You're in danger, and I won't have that." "Keep your shirt on, Casper," Rick said with a scornful laugh. "This nut is supposedly after me, not Maddie. Why don't you leave us alone and go hover over some of your other clients, if you have any, that is?" "Rick!" Maddie cried sharply. "It's all right, Maddie. He doesn't bother me, as long as you're all right." "I'm fine, Dwayne. Please don't worry about me." Maddie smiled at him warmly. "Honest." "Yeah, don't worry, old buddy. I'll take care of Maddie," Rick said, trying to assure him. "Oh, I'm sure you will," Dwayne sneered. Then he turned to Maddie and took her by the hand, looking deeply into her eyes. "I want you to promise me that you'll call me if there's any more trouble on set." Maddie nodded, then Dwayne walked off, throwing a nasty look over his shoulder at Rick. "For Pete's sake, Maddie," Rick muttered before Dwayne was out of earshot. "When are you going to dump that jerk and get yourself a real agent?" "Dwayne's not so bad," Maddie answered, watching the man disappear. "Remember, he took me on as a client when nobody else would even give me an interview." "But you've come a long way since then. You're a star now. You should have a major agency representing you," he said as they started walking to catch up with Nancy. "I don't know. Somehow I feel like a rat if I left Dwayne." "All I know is a major agency could get you a lot more work and a lot more money, and a girl with your talent deserves the best." Seeing he was getting nowhere, Rick threw up his hands. "All right, I won't say another word. You know how I feel, though." He stopped in front of an expensive-looking restaurant. "Here we are. Serena, Nurse Sanford, Nurse Johnson, would you care to have lunch with me?" he said, opening the restaurant door for them. It's Saturday morning and time for another edition of Soap Opera Weekly, where we bring you the latest on your favorite shows and introduce you to the stars, the television announcer was saying as Bess shook Nancy's shoulder. "Wake up, Nancy Drew," Bess said, mimicking the announcer. "Come on, the alarm went off 10 minutes ago. Your aunt's still sleeping, so I wheeled the TV in here. Rick's going to be on Soap Opera Weekly this morning. We can watch while we get dressed." Nancy mumbled, burying her face under the pillow. Was it really morning already? She and Bess and her Aunt Eloise had had such a great time the night before. They'd gone to see Soft Shoe, the Broadway musical smash of the season. The show was wonderful, but they'd stopped for a bite to eat afterward. By the time they got home, it was almost 1 a.m. Flipping over and squinting at the TV, Nancy saw shots of different soap opera stars as the upbeat theme song played in the background. "Our special Soap Opera Weekly guest today is the star of Danner's Dream," the announcer said. "Will he and Serena Livingstone finally tie the knot this time? Mr. Sex Appeal himself, Rick Arlen, will be here with us in just a few minutes. But first," the commercial came on, and Nancy realized there was no way she was going to get back to sleep. Not with Bess rummaging around the room, tossing one outfit after another on the bed and saying things like, "What do you think, Nancy, the pink or the yellow?" Pulling herself up on her elbows, Nancy yawned and looked out the window. It was a glorious day outside, warm and sunny, a perfect day for seeing the sights, she thought happily. "He's on! He's on!" Bess shouted a few minutes later. Nancy turned away from the closet and saw Rick. He was seated casually across from the interviewer, waving and nodding as the audience clapped and cheered. Cleverly refusing to give away any of the show's carefully guarded secrets, Rick did admit that he was considering leaving the show at the end of the season to star in a movie. The audience groaned, then applauded. "Tell us about the real Rick Arlen," the interviewer prompted. "Could we be hearing wedding bells soon?" Laughing, Rick made an old joke about the gossip columns having him engaged to 3 different girls. "But then you never can tell," he added slyly, blowing a kiss to a special lady out there. "He means me," Bess cried happily. "I don't think so. That's just talk, Bess. He could mean anybody or nobody." Bess shot her friend an angry scowl, and Nancy decided to back off. After the interview with Rick, the show moved on to an update of that network's daytime and evening soap operas. Bess snapped the TV off then. "He said he'd be here in an hour. I can't wait." Bess scooped up her makeup and headed for the bathroom. "Yeah, I wonder who he'll bring for you, Nancy. I mean, any friend of Rick's is probably cute, but I wonder what he'll be like. An hour later, the apartment intercom buzzed, signaling the arrival of Rick and his limousine. Bess checked herself in the mirror one last time. She looked terrific in an oversized cotton cardigan and flowing skirt and flats. Not bad, she pronounced. Come on, Nancy. With that, she flew down the steps of the brownstone to the waiting limousine. Not bad at all, Nancy admitted, looking admiringly at Rick's limo. The uniformed driver ushered them into the back seat where Rick was waiting. Good morning, girls, he said brightly. Welcome to my abode on the road. The first order of business was to pick up Rick's friend, a guy named Gilbert Frost. He's an old pal from acting school, Rick explained. You'll love him. Bess threw Nancy a meaningful look, but Nancy just sighed and looked out the window. There was no way she was going to fall for any of Rick Arlen's friends, not when she was in love with Ned Nickerson. Of course, Ned would understand her being on this date. She had to go. Someone's life was in jeopardy. At the corner of 23rd Street and Park Avenue South, she noticed a skinny guy in jeans and running shoes leaning against a streetlight. He looked totally normal, except for the fact that he was wearing big, black-rimmed glasses and a false nose. What? Nancy mumbled as the limo stopped in front of him. The man swept down in a low, courtly bow. Hey there, Gil, Rick laughed, opening the door. Girls, I'd like you to meet Gilbert Frost. Say hello, Gilbert. Hello, Gilbert, the guy mimicked, sliding into the plush limo. Bess was giggling uncontrollably, and Nancy couldn't help smiling as Rick's friend took off his glasses, revealing another pair underneath. Finally, they pulled into traffic, and Nancy got a good look at Gilbert. Without his getup on, he was pretty cute. He had glossy black hair and warm brown eyes that twinkled with laughter. Gil's going to be the next host at the Comedy Basement, Rick said. He does stand up. I also do sit up and grow up, Gil announced. Everyone groaned. Throwing a proprietary arm around Bess's shoulder, Rick instructed the driver to take them to 42nd Street and the Hudson River. Today we're going to do all those corny things you see in old movies about New York, Rick said, like go on a boat trip around Manhattan and to the top of the Empire State Building. Bess is an old-fashioned girl, he explained to his friend. Rick Arlen, I am not, Bess protested. Secretly, though, she was flattered by his remark. By the time they got to the West Side Pier, the four of them were relaxed and having a great time. Before leaving the limo, Rick put on sunglasses and an old hat. That way, most of his face was covered. Just normal precautions, he insisted. These go everywhere with me, otherwise, the fans. Well, I'm sure you can imagine. I think you look adorable like that, Gilbert said. Rick punched his friend lightly on the arm, and they all piled out of the car. So, Gil, how did you get involved in show business? Nancy asked while they waited on the deck for the cruise to start. Oh, now we're going way back to the day little Freddie Gilbert was born in Illinois in a log cabin. No, just kidding. How did I get involved in show business, you ask? Thank goodness someone cares besides my mother. In spite of his nonstop chatter and put-down humor, Nancy decided she liked Gil. He seemed a little lonely somehow and afraid to be just himself, but instinct told her he had a good heart. He had a good heart. I can't talk. You see, my real name is Fred Gilbert. I had to change it after I got to New York. There already was a Fred Gilbert out there in the show business stratosphere. And so Gilbert Frost was born. But he had the wrong nose, so I changed that too. And then I had to darken my hair. By the time I was finished, the same club owners who used to tell me to get lost were trying to sign me. What can I tell you? It's a crazy business. Maybe someday I'll even make enough to pay my rent. And if I'm really lucky, I might even hit it big, like old Rick here. I'm sure you will, Nancy said, looking up. The view from the boat was spectacular. The skyline sparkled in the noon sun. But as the boat trip continued and they finally circled the tip of Manhattan, Nancy couldn't help feeling that something was wrong. All through the ride, she had been keeping an eye on Rick, and she noticed other people were watching him too. Nancy saw two women look at him, jab each other, and whisper, and a child tugged on his father's sleeve and pointed toward Rick. A portly man was also watching him, although he pretended to be looking at something else. As the boat swung into the final leg of the tour, Nancy recognized the portly man. He had been the one cursing Rory Danner on the tour of the set just 2 days before. Attention, ladies and gentlemen, we will be docking in a few minutes. Please disembark via the white stairs on the port side of the boat. That's the left to all you landlubbers, the tour guide instructed. That's him, that's Rick Arlen, a young woman suddenly shrieked. An excited murmur went through the crowd and everyone turned to look at Rick. Take the hat off, Rory, we know it's you, a woman called out good-naturedly. The group laughed and Rick cooperated. Ah, oh, fans, he smiled and waved. You're the greatest, all of you. I love you madly. Rick, could I have your autograph? A woman cried happily. Everyone crowded around him and began rifling through their bags for pens, too. Write one for my niece, Rick. Oh, Mr. Arlen, thank you. Rick was standing by the guardrail, signing the backs of envelopes, napkins, address books, and matchbook covers. Suddenly, the man who'd been on the studio tour lunged forward, his eyes wild, his voice like thunder. You killed Jill Rowan, and now you want to destroy Serena Livingstone. Well, I won't let you. I'm not going to let filth like you near her. You're going to die, Rory Danner, right now. With that, the man lunged for Rick, sending him halfway over the rail. He was about to plunge into the river. End of chapter 7. Getting pretty crazy. That didn't happen in the game. He's like one of those guys that's like super out of touch with reality or whatever. But anyway. Just checking something real quick. Okay, moving on. Chapter 8. What page? I hope that's by a dog. Yes, this book just got real. Chapter 8. Leaping for Rick, Nancy and Gilbert grabbed him just in time and pulled him safely back over the rail. Nancy felt a pair of ham-like hands on her shoulders. She turned to face the assailant and delivered a swift kick to his left shin. Then she seized his hand and flipped him head over heels onto the deck. The ship's crew then held him pinned against the deck until the ship had docked and the police arrived, followed by a couple of reporters. "Okay, fellows, let's go," a police officer said, leading the man to a patrol car. "You'll feel a lot better after a nice long rest." "I killed Rory Danner, and the world will be a better place for it," the man exclaimed. "He was filth. Filth." "Sure, sure," another police officer said, agreeing. "You can tell the doctor all about it." As their limo pulled out of the parking lot, the crowd cheered Rick. He was leaning out the window, smiling and waving. "Thank you, everyone," he called. He slipped back into the car. "Well, thank goodness that's over. And thank you, Gil and Nancy." Turning to Bess, he added, "You certainly know how to pick your friends, love." Gil still seemed a bit shaken. "You know, Rick, the way you were hanging over the edge, I thought you were history." He shuddered. "I'm going to sign up for karate lessons next week. I just want to be prepared for fame." "Let's just put the whole thing behind us, okay? Now it's time to celebrate." Rick grinned devilishly. "Why not go for the best, driver?" Later, riding up the escalator from the lobby of a brass and marble palace, Bess and Nancy looked around in wonder. This place was amazing. "This makes the River Heights Mall look like a mom-and-pop store," Nancy whispered. She looked all around her as they rose ever higher through the glittering atrium. "Tell me about it," Bess said enthusiastically. "Rick, I can't believe people actually live in this building." "They do," he assures her. "There are apartments here that sell for millions." "Seriously?" Bess couldn't believe it. "What do they have, solid gold faucets?" "Almost," Gil replied. "You'd be amazed at what people spend their money on." "Cappuccino, anyone?" Rick broke in cheerfully. They'd just come to an attractive cafe on an upper level. Soon they were all sitting around a table sipping cups of the strong Italian coffee. "You know what being here makes me realize?" Bess was saying. "I've realized that I'd make a great millionaire." "I think you'd make a lovely one, too," Rick said, flirting. "In fact, I saw something in a shop across the way that I think you should have. I'll be right back." A minute later, Rick came back to the table, holding a silk scarf printed in pastel geometric shapes. It matched Bess's outfit perfectly. "Rick," she exclaimed, "it's beautiful." "Wear it and think of me," he murmured. "So, everyone, are you ready to scale the heights? It's such a clear, beautiful day. What do you say we catch the view from the Empire State Building?" "Sounds great." Bess was beaming. Anything Rick said would have sounded great to her. "I used to sell souvenirs at the observatory," Gil threw in. "That was when I still worked for a living." He straightened up and helped Nancy from her chair. "Madam?" he said. "Your chariot awaits. That is, Rick's chariot awaits," he said, correcting himself. By the time they reached 34th Street and had made their way up to the top, the sun had slipped much closer to the horizon. Rick and Bess, their arms around each other's waists, stood at the observatory's edge, gazing into the distance. Gil had stopped to chat with his old co-workers at the souvenir shop, so Nancy wandered off by herself. Up that high, the wind cut like a knife, seeming to come from all directions. It blew Nancy's hair wildly around her as she started down at the magical city. The noise from the street sounded like a low moan up there, almost human and full of sadness. It made Nancy shudder for a moment. As she looked out over the city below her, she felt a growing sense of dread. The police had arrested the deranged fan that afternoon, but she was still worried. In the late afternoon sun, Nancy had a sudden, powerful feeling that someone else was after Rick. Someone who was not only crazy, but also clever, determined, and deadly. Nancy felt an icy shiver go through her. Someone was waiting down on the street. She was sure of it. Waiting to end Rick Arlen's life. Bess scooped up one last mouthful of chocolate mousse pie and sighed contentedly. "What a dinner! I'm in heaven!" "Not bad," Gil agreed, glancing around at the glass walls of Tavern on the Green. Positioned on the edge of Central Park, the view out the windows of the restaurant was of trees decorated with tiny white lights. The park looked like an enchanted fairyland in direct contrast to the city around it. When the check came, Rick picked it up. "What's money for, if not to treat friends?" he asked, placing a gold credit card on the small black lacquered tray the waiter had brought. "What a day," Bess remarked happily. "What a night, too. I've had such a fabulous time today, Rick, thanks to you." Rick looked genuinely pleased as he took her hand in his. "There's just one more thing I'd like to do. I could use a little exercise after this dinner, and it's such a great night. Why don't we take a walk inside the park?" Bess's eyes were twinkling with delight. Rick seemed to be having a hard time saying goodnight to her. "A walk does sound wonderful," Nancy said. "Good, we're on," Gil agreed. Stepping out onto the sidewalk along the park, Rick and Bess linked arms. They were completely caught up in each other as they giggled and joked, walking ahead of the other two. Nancy watched them carefully as she half-listened to Gil, who was telling her the rest of his life story. "Then I realized I had to change my material," he was saying. "Nobody goes for rubber chicken jokes anymore, so I began writing myself a whole new act." Nancy couldn't help worrying about Bess. She was heading for trouble, Nancy was sure of that. Even if Rick was sincere, how could it last? They lived miles from each other, and a broken heart was the last thing that Bess needed. The sound of a speeding car made Nancy spin around. A taxicab jumped its lane and screeched diagonally across the street. Suddenly, a broken heart was the least of Bess's troubles. The out-of-control cab was headed onto the sidewalk, aimed straight at Rick and Bess.
"Oh my goodness. They're gonna get hit by a car. Ouch."
There's a makeup chat happening. And there's so much blue in my chat. It's just like two different blues. Okay. I think I might do one more chapter. Yeah. Chapter 9. "Watch out!" Nancy screamed. Racing up to pull Bess away from the oncoming taxi, she managed to get just close enough to grab her friend's arm as the taxi swerved onto the sidewalk. It barely missed the stunned Bess before jumping the curb back onto the street and careening away. Bess stood absolutely still in the middle of the sidewalk. "Nancy, am I okay?" she asked in a dazed voice. "Your shirt is torn, but I think you're fine." Suddenly, Bess looked around frantically. "Rick, where's Rick?" "Right here," he answered. They all turned and saw Rick's head poking out from behind a tree. "See, I told you it would take a silver bullet to get me. Not even a scratch," he added, proudly showing them his arms and legs. "Don't tell me that was just an accident," Gil stammered, running a hand nervously through his hair. "He never even hit the brakes." "He's right, Rick." Bess seemed quite shaken now. "Maybe there's more than one crazy fan after you." Nancy bit her lip and thought for a moment. This latest incident confirmed her worst fears. She knew now that the crude attempt on Rick's life on the boat trip was just a sideshow. The main event was still to come. Gil was still shaking. "Well, I don't know about you folks," he said, "but I've had about all the excitement I can take for one day. Next time we get together, Rick, remind me to take out extra insurance." "Hey, calm down. It's the peace of life in the fast lane, that's all." Rick laughed nervously. "Come on, I'll give you a lift home on my way downtown." "Bess?" Turning to Bess, he pulled her gently to him and gave her a kiss. They walked back to the limo, and Nancy and Gil climbed in. Nancy turned her head away, embarrassed, while Bess and Rick stood out on the sidewalk. They were whispering, probably about what had just happened. Nancy frowned. Things looked bad, very bad indeed. It was as if Bess hadn't even noticed that she and Rick had almost been killed. "It's just a feeling I get, Ned, but it's a strong one. Something is very wrong here." Nancy flung herself down on the dark blue sofa and filled her boyfriend, Ned Nickerson, in on everything that had happened since she'd arrived in New York. "I only wish you weren't so far away," she sighed. "Same here," Ned agreed. "I miss you." "I miss you too, and I could really use your help on this case." "Can I do anything from here?" "Honestly, I don't think so, except share a little of your wonderful insight. I'm completely baffled by this whole thing right now." "Sounds like you need some on-the-scene help. I'd be on the next flight, but I have a big paper due. I do want you to promise not to take any unnecessary chances, though." "Come on, Ned, you know me. I'm always very careful," Nancy said, teasing him. "Yes, I know. That's why I want you to keep a low profile. I want you to be in one piece the next time I see you." Nancy blew a kiss into the phone and said goodbye. After she hung up, she smiled sadly. If only Ned were able to meet her in New York. Just then, the front doorbell rang. Nancy went to open it, and before her stood Maddie Jensen. Her rich auburn hair was pulled up in a ponytail, and she was wearing jeans and a sweatshirt. She looked almost as young as Nancy. "Hey, kiddo," the actress said, bubbling. "Eloise told me she was going to the ballet tonight, so I thought you guys might want a little company." "How could anyone as beautiful and successful as Maddie Jensen be all alone at 10 o'clock on a Saturday night?" Nancy wondered. It didn't seem possible. But there she was. "She's lonely," Nancy realized. "Sure, come on in," she said. "Bess is in the shower." "Hey, I read about what happened to you today on the boat trip." "After everything he's been through, Rick must be glad they caught that guy. They said the man tried to throw him overboard." "Mm-hmm," Nancy replied, wishing she could have shared Maddie's sense of relief. "They said the guy was released from a mental institution a few weeks ago." "I didn't hear that, but from the way he was acting..." Nancy's voice trailed off. "Oh, Nancy, I'm so relieved. Now I'll finally be able to sleep at night." Maddie smiled softly, but Nancy just turned away. "What's the matter, Nancy? Are you still upset?" Nancy heaved an enormous sigh. "Maddie, I hate to say this. I know you're not going to like it, but I don't think the man they arrested today is the person that we're after." "But they said that he had been stalking Rick for weeks." "He may have been, but I don't think he's the one who tampered with the light and sent the chocolates." Maddie gazed at Nancy in amazement. Then she nodded. "Okay. Tell me why you think it isn't the same person." "Two reasons. For starters, someone tried to run Rick over tonight." "What?" Maddie exclaimed. "I'm afraid so. Don't try and tell Rick that. He insists it was a hit-and-run accident. But I was there, Maddie. The cab never blew its horn, never slowed down, and the license plate was covered over with mud. It may all be circumstantial evidence, but..." Maddie was silent, taking it all in. "And then," Nancy said, continuing, "there's the photograph of Rick, the one that was all scratched up. It wasn't just a publicity shot, the kind that he might autograph for a fan. There was a resume for all the shows he's been in stapled to the back of it. Correct me if I'm wrong, but actors don't give out their resumes to the general public, do they?" "No, of course not, but lots of people would have them." "Like who? A producer?" "Sure. When an actor auditions for a job, he always brings a picture and a resume," she said, sitting down. "Pappas would have them. So would the director and Lillian, of course. His agent would have hundreds. I suppose even Dwayne might have a few left, unless he cleaned out his files recently." Maddie stared at the wall with a faraway look. "But Dwayne is harmless. I'm sure... Wait, why Dwayne? I thought Rick said he was with international management." "Yes, but when Rick was first in New York, Dwayne was his agent. The summer I first met both of them, we were in an acting company doing Shakespeare in Oregon. We were so sure of ourselves," she mused. "Anyway, that fall we set out for New York in the big time. Rick and I did all right, but Dwayne, who was trying to make it as an actor, still ran into trouble getting parts. He was the wrong type somehow, so he decided to open a talent agency instead. He really got our careers moving, too." Just then, Bess stepped into the room, a terry bathrobe wrapped around her. "I thought I heard somebody. Hi, Maddie," she chirped. "Did Nancy tell you about our day? It was kind of wild, huh?" I read about part of it in the paper, Maddie said. It was... The telephone rang, interrupting her. That's probably for me, Bess said as she dove for the phone. Oh, hi, she purred into the receiver. Yes, I thought you might... Really? Suddenly, Bess turned a deep crimson and let out a wild giggle. Just a minute, she said. I think I'll take this in the other room. Carefully putting the receiver on its side, Bess gestured wildly at Nancy and then at the phone. It's Rick, she whispered excitedly. Hang up for me, okay? With that, she ran into the bedroom. Nancy turned to Maddie. She was pale, and her glamorous face was drawn tight. Staring vacantly toward the bedroom, her enormous eyes began to fill with tears. Nancy replaced the receiver. Maddie, she whispered gently, you still love him, don't you? Maddie collapsed back into her chair. Yes, I do. Heaven knows why, she answered. Just a habit, I guess. I've loved him since I first saw him, and we've been through a lot together. Nancy put her hand comfortingly on Maddie's arm. As they listened to Bess giggling happily in the other room, Nancy could feel Maddie's grief. If a girl were talking with Ned like that, she'd be crushed too. But then, Maddie said with a sad smile, Rick doesn't feel the same way. Well, I'd better go. I might as well get some sleep. We're still having brunch tomorrow morning, right? Nancy nodded and walked Maddie to the door, watching as she went down the stairs to her garden apartment. Just as the actress was about to disappear, Nancy remembered what she had been thinking before the phone rang. Maddie, wait, she called. The actress looked up from the stairwell. Yes? How could I get into Dwayne Casper's office? I'd like to just take a look around. Well, said Maddie, her brow wrinkling as she thought, I suppose you could set up an appointment and say you were an aspiring actress. You could even say we did a show together once. That might work. I don't think he ever noticed me before. Whenever I saw him, I wasn't near you or him, but I don't have any pictures or resumes, she reminded Maddie. That's okay, Maddie assured her. Just tell him you're new in town. Ask him for advice. He loves that. Dwayne's really good with newcomers, and he'll be flattered that you came to him for guidance. If you call first thing Monday morning and say I told you to call, I guarantee you'll get in. But I promise you, Dwayne is harmless. I should know. We've been friends for years. I hope you're right, but if Dwayne's got anything to do with this, I've got to find out. And Maddie, she said softly, don't worry about Bess. I know her. She falls in and out of love all the time. She'll get over Rick as soon as she gets back home. You'll see. Maddie stared into the distance, trying to hide her feelings. Maybe, she murmured softly. Giving Nancy a strange look, she disappeared down the stairwell to her apartment. Nancy could hear her door close behind her. That night, tossing and turning in her bed, Nancy couldn't sleep. Her eyes kept popping open, and she'd lie still and stare at the ceiling while her mind was in high gear and she worked through detail after detail. If only they added up. Rick Arlen. She could picture his handsome face with that winning grin of his and those sparkling azure eyes. Someone wanted him dead, but who? Rick might not win any popularity contests among the people who knew him best, but only one person hated him enough to want him dead. It took a very clever person to conceal such powerful hatred so successfully. Nancy tried to imagine who it might be, but there were so many people wishing him ill. Pappas, Casper, Lillian Weiss, and who knows how many others there were just on the set alone. Nancy had cases this difficult before, and she'd solved them successfully, but this time there were so many possibilities. Which one should she investigate first? As she drifted to sleep, the shadowy figure of Rick came back into her mind. He was signing autographs for a crowd of fans. A monstrous figure walked toward him, slowly stalking him. Nancy tried to cry out, but her voice was caught in her throat. The figure turned toward her, seeing her for the first time. Eyes of indescribable evil glowed at her, paralyzing her with fear. Then the figure drew a long and sharp knife that glinted in the dim light. Nancy tried to scream, but nothing happened. The shadowy figure was getting closer and closer. Nancy awoke with a gasp and sat up in bed. The clock radio by her bed read 5:05 a.m. It was only a dream, thank goodness, she thought, her heart racing, but it was so real. Sighing with relief, she turned over, ready to go back to sleep. That's when she noticed that Bess's bed was empty. In an instant, Nancy was up and out of bed. She hurried into the kitchen. No Bess. She checked the bathroom, the living room, then ran back to the bedroom. Nothing. It couldn't be, but it was. Bess was gone. Dun, dun, dun. That's end of chapter 9. Hi, Brooke. Sorry I didn't say hey to you earlier. I just didn't want to interrupt my reading. Yes, I would read your blog if you interviewed the trilogy. Girl, you secretly like Frank. Dwayne Casper, yes, the name is different. Obviously, Timo likes Rick, so there's that. You haven't even played this, though. So, you gotta play it, Timo. Or watch someone play it. You could go to my YouTube and watch my old stream of it. Anyway, how's everybody doing? It's 4:30, so I think I'm gonna stop, even though we only did four chapters. Think I'm gonna call it a night. I might be back on later. So my aunt is coming into town in like an hour and a half, and I worked all day on my house, so that's why I took a little stream break. But I think I'm gonna go start prepping dinner so that it'll be ready when they are here. So I might be back on later. They have two really young kids, so they might be in bed early. And if so, I may come back in and do some Cat President or some more reading or something. I don't know yet. But I'll leave you with some music. Thanks for stopping in. I appreciate all of you very much. Take care of yourselves. Much love from me to you, and I'll see you all very soon. Bye.